up of the council meeting of July 13, 2016. Roll call, Councilmember Chapman.
Here.
Councilmember Clayton.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please. Flag salute. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster and Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Matters by the city council?
I have nothing.
Okay. In May, as you may or may not be aware, was Older Americans Month, and John and I had the opportunity to be invited to take to participate, I guess because we're older Americans.
And Jesse.
And Jesse. At the Asbury Park. At the Asbury Park Senior Center. So, and this year's theme was Blaze a Trail, and it talked about the seniors and how they blazed a trail for all of us. So we just wanted to recognize those seniors who were there. Two of them, Ruth Abramowitz and Dolores Holland, are both over 90 and are both active, vibrant people, so we wanted to congratulate them. And the others are Rodney Boyce, Nancy Dawson, Juanita Felder, Renee Freeman, Lois Harrison, Gertrude Hudson, Ellen Jackson, Herbert Jackson, Hyacinth James, Rose Johnson, Lily Jones, Roger Krause, Bernice Lance, Ruth Laws, Willie Martin, Lizzie Mosley, Sarah Patterson, Louise Riney, Thelma Streaks, Cheryl Strickland, Marcia Turbin, Peggy Weaver, and Virginia Williams. And we want to thank them for contributing to the vitality and revitalization of Asbury Park. And next, last night, there was a meeting of clergy, organizational leaders from the city, residents, law enforcement, and the mayor and myself at St. Stephen's Church. And the purpose was to talk about what's going on in the country and what we can do here in our city to bring about unity and to get ready for the summer and just to bring our community together. So we're making plans. There are short-range plans and long-range plans, but the first plan is on Friday evening at 6 o'clock. There's going to be a prayer vigil, and we're asking everyone to come out. It's going to be 1 hour. It will be on Springwood Avenue and Fisher, and we've chosen that spot because it's a combination of Asbury Park and Neptune, and that is where the city line is. So we're asking all people who can to please come out and join us tomorrow evening, and again, that's 6 o'clock.
Friday.
I'm sorry, tomorrow's Thursday, Friday evening. Thank you.
Anyone else? I'd like to just speak on the summer program. It's going very well. We have over 100 children participating, and they're coming in every day by the groves. And that rodeo is really going to help us out this year, so we appreciate all of that. And I also like to thank everyone for coming out on Mondays, the various Mondays that we've been having at Springwood Avenue Park. I understand that the crowd is increasing more and more, but you can also help by communicating to your neighbor or your friend and ask them to come and check it out. We're looking forward to hearing from you and seeing you there. And there's a lot of good talent there. It's all type of music, and it's been going well. So continue to come, and thank you for coming.
And we mentioned these Monday night. I'm just going to throw them out again. In your tax bill this month, you should have gotten a pamphlet from the city, describing some of the activities and things going on in the city. And you also should have gotten frequently asked questions, which hopefully answered some of your questions regarding your taxes. The other thing the city's doing is the beach. There is a beach pass app for your phone. So those of you who are going to the beach and you're waiting on lines for daily or seasonal passes, you can actually download the app and buy the pass. So you don't have to wait online. That's it.
Matters by city manager.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Earlier today, earlier yesterday, we received bids for the Sunset Avenue footbridge. They came in higher than anticipated, but still within the range of the engineer. What we're going to be requesting at the next meeting is to increase the capital ordinance another $125,000 to complete the project. Please keep in mind this is reimbursable by FEMA, so our costs are only 10%. We recouped the 90% of it. But again, all the costs were in the engineer's range. Earlier today, myself, bond counsel, financial advisor, and CFO attended the local finance board meeting in Trenton for ordinance on tonight for second reading and adoption, 2016-28, which is the repaving of the Fourth Avenue. The local finance board unanimously approved that application, and we can go ahead and adopt the ordinance tonight if you deem fit. The local finance board chairman, who's also the director of local government services, Mr. Tim Cunningham. Mr. Cunningham wanted me to express to you as a council the great work that you guys have been doing here. He made it well known how you've been very, very good in moving the city forward. He also wanted to thank the city. He said we were the only large city in the state that had every person respond to the financial disclosure form, which that is the work of Cindy for getting that done. It's a lot of work. We were in default last year where a lot of people didn't do it, but Cindy should be congratulated on actually getting that done, and Tim brought it up in the meeting. So it was the people before us didn't do it, and the people before them. So thank you, Cindy, for getting that done.
Could you use the mic, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm recommending tabling ordinance 2016-30. That is the summer rental CO ordinance. There is still much debate among staff and from talking to many of the council members and some of the citizenry. At this point in time, we know that we need to make a bigger and larger ordinance. My recommendation is that we do it once and do it right and try to cover everything, especially since there's only 6 weeks left in the season. By the time this is adopted and implemented, it's the end of the season. There's issues throughout the year that should be addressed, so I'm recommending that it be tabled. There's two resolutions added to the agenda tonight. One is amending the temporary appropriations budget for 2016, which is the standard increasing of appropriations until we get the budget adopted, which will be later this year. And resolution 2016-312, which is refunds for a special event. We did not do our part of what we were supposed to. The applicant paid and needs to be reimbursed. Lastly, to follow up on the workshop meeting, there was discussion on how to make the lines at the beach move faster. One, as you heard the deputy mayor say, is to use the Viply app, which is right now only available on iOS. It should be coming to Android sooner than later. We've done some more marketing for it. We were going to add it to one of our digital signs, but I found out it was broken. So we're gonna try to fix that as soon as possible.
The digital sign?
The one on Main Street, we're adding it or have added, but we had two of the larger ones. One works, it's the one that's down by the ocean now for speed. The other one is broken. So I instructed staff to fix it. And talking to the beach manager, Gary Iverson Sr., he's been working with Bill McClave, the DPW superintendent, to either create or purchase another booth and actually put it down on the boardwalk in another place so that there's not a concentration of the line, adding actually another place to accept funds. Because Garrett has seen the lines also.
But Eileen's point I thought was good. Can we put little sandwich boards telling people around some of the busier ticket places to start, to just let them know you can just download this and not wait in this line, particularly by the trailer, because that's got the worst lines on, is that second? Second Ave. The trailer's the worst, Fifth is not great, and I sit at Fifth, so I don't know about the other lines.
They're bad.
They're all bad. We'll just put a couple up, certainly one by the trailer.
I'm going to ask if it's okay with everyone for the menu item with this, because there's still some money left in signs, so that the signage is consistent throughout the boardwalk.
Okay.
And see how fast Madison Marquette can get it up. And if they can't get it up fast enough, then we'll look to do it ourselves through the beach utility. But there is money left on the menu item.
Okay.
That's all. Thank you.
Money left on the?
On the sign portion of the menu
item. On the sign portion, okay.
Can you do that quick, Chris?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. I didn't know you were here.
Matters by city attorney?
I have no matters at this time.
And can I have a motion to open the public portion of the meeting?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor? The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order, and after appropriate warning may terminate any further comments from the speaker. Each speaker has 3 minutes to speak, and when you come to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Motion to close. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
The events of the past 2 weeks prompt this speech tonight. I grieve for all the men killed, the black men and the men in blue. What I have to say takes a little bit longer than 3 minutes. And if you need to cut me off, my friend Halcyon Isaac will finish my speech. Councilwoman Clayton, thank you for the announcement you made earlier this evening. Anyway, I can help, let me know. I would normally come to the microphone here at our city council meetings to speak about complete streets and the positive effects road diet will have on Main Street, or about the upcoming modifications to the city master plan, or maybe about the noise coming from the Asbury Hotel. I do this advocating because I firmly believe that any and all change and reform must begin at the local level. If we want county, state, or federal changes, it must begin at the local level. If we want changes to the overall system of justice in our country, it must begin at the local level. I've had conversations with residents and city employees about justice in our community and in our country. There are those who believe that because we in Asbury Park have not had any recent violence reflecting racial or economic imbalance, that everything is fine. They say, leave it alone. But I cannot, because there is racial and economic imbalance in Asbury Park. That in and of itself is wrong and must be addressed, and now is the time. We are all talking to each other, but are we listening? A few weeks ago, there were 4 petitions presented to the city clerk for inclusion on the next election ballot. These petitions represented an unrest in the city. Those petitions were a message. Those petitions were residents talking to other residents and to the city council, but were we listening? Were you listening? The message was delivered in a respectful and legal manner. The petitions were rejected. There was no public explanation of their message, nor was there a public explanation of why they were rejected. The petition creators and signatories were speaking, but we were not listening. Well, I have had enough, and I am listening. We all know that the creators and the signatories of those petitions were black, and black lives and opinions and concerns matter, and I am listening. I am respectfully asking the City Council to read the petitions and listen to the message of those petitions, not only the actual words, but the message behind those words. I am asking residents and city employees to ask for copies of the petitions and read the words and listen to the message. And then I am respectfully and legally requesting change. I am demanding change. Asbury Park needs to recognize inequities in our city. Those people counted as the have-nots need to be heard by the haves. If you believe, as I do, that there is a bias concerning arrests and convictions against our black and brown brothers, even if the fix is at the county, state, or federal level, talk to our local judge about what we can do locally, out of the box. If there's an inequity regarding incarceration, let's do something about it. And don't tell me that there's nothing you as a city council can do. Shall I have Halcyon finish it?
Yeah, how long?
Another 2 minutes.
Go ahead.
Write letters to state officials on city letterhead, lobby at the League of Municipality meeting, and initiate dialogue with the county. Because there are people, residents, some white, but especially black, who feel that they do not have a say in how the city is run and how the city reacts to their problems, you, the most sympathetic council in years, need to create an environment and a mechanism to listen. Create a position or an office of ombudsman, or create a civilian review board that reacts to police and other actions. You, as the city council, can create any committee that you want to create. It can be volunteer or paid. It can have power or can just recommend. It can be large or small, but make sure it is multicolor and make sure it is membered by people who listen, and make sure you listen to its recommendations. Black lives matter. If your reaction to that message is to say all lives matter, then you do not understand the message. Open your hearts and your minds. Black people in America and black people in Asbury Park feel like white neighbors do not think they matter. Listen to the message. It is not a threat. Listen and act. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Linda Phillips, 1302 Bridge Street. I am here to support Pam's letter. I think it's important that we listen to all the people in our city. I vaguely remember reading something about those petitions a long time ago in the Sun or someplace like that. Didn't know that they were rejected. I would like to see them. I think we should all see them and know what was on them and have it as a discussion. And I agree that a committee or something could be formed to talk about these kind of issues. They shouldn't just be ignored. So I'm supporting that.
Thank you. I'm just curious, what petition was this? When was this? Did we all get them?
I believe what has been referred to are the petitions that were submitted some time ago under the initiative and referendum process under the Faulkner Act, which is now applicable in our new form of government, that certain matters be brought forward to the mayor and council, but defects had been determined with regard to the petitions that had been submitted. There was a public indication after the petitions were received by the clerk. I do remember that the clerk read a statement into the record as to the contents of the petitions and the reasons for why they were rejected, and we can go back into the record and review what was said at that time.
Okay, thank you.
What was the reason they were rejected? Sorry, I didn't quite follow you, Fred.
It's public information, so there was a letter that was sent, and it can be obtained through the Open Public Records Act, but there were legal deficiencies that were cited with regard to the questions that were brought forward. The concerns that were raised were that the questions that were brought forward were not eligible to be moved forward to the next level because of the fact that they either violated existing state law or case law, and there was a determination that was rendered and was forwarded to mayor and council, and a statement was read into the record at an open public meeting by the city clerk. And there is litigation right now pending with regard to that matter.
Okay, thanks. Maureen Nevin Dealey, Court. Sorry, I got a frog in my throat. Speaking of open public meetings and executive sessions, I'd like to know what the process is, Fred, when you're still meeting an executive session to discuss something that's going to be in a resolution, and the minutes for those executive sessions about that item that's going to be in the resolution still haven't been released to the public. Is the council free to go ahead and pass the resolution?
Yes, council can pass a resolution before minutes are approved relating to the executive session where they have had a discussion regarding the contents of a resolution. Let's just say if you're referring to a resolution approving an agreement, it's commonplace for the council to discuss the contents of an agreement as a contract negotiation in executive session, and they may take action at the same meeting where they had discussion during the executive session prior to the public portion of the meeting. And then the minutes regarding that would be available at some point thereafter.
But that would be a problem because the public cannot participate in that that part of the government process because they're not informed. So I'd like to hear more about that, but I have 1.29, 28 seconds. Okay. Let's see. Okay. The Baronet. It's very nice. I'd like to compliment iStar for putting the neon sign for the Baronet on top of the roof and putting up that screen. But you know, in the New York Times travel section this week, they made reference to the fact, that was the opening line, in fact, was about how the real Baronet Theater, the roof collapsed and it had to be demolished. Now, is there anybody here who can tell me what really happened to the Baronet? Maybe Jim? The other people who were on the preservation committee of the Historical Society? The Baronet was allowed to go into decay. We had started to repair it. You know, we're losing a lot of what Asbury Park, the appeal that it has to people coming into town. And I know that, what's his name, Sugarman, has been quoted saying that he realizes that this is a problem too. But I hope that the council will try and do something about these things. Would you address that, please?
Are you saying do something about the inaccuracies of a New York Times article?
No, no.
What I'm saying is, you're saying do something about historic preservation.
Yes, okay. Yes. Yeah. Before,
so you know,
before the roof caves in and it has to be demolished.
Yeah. And just so you know, when we put a personnel committee together, and one of the things about Michelle Alonso that was such a huge sell for her was she has won, and I'm going to say it wrong now because I don't remember, but a bunch of preservation awards. So that was the number one thing that we looked at when we were interviewing city planners. So I think, you know, we're absolutely on the same page as that. Michelle, didn't you win some preservation award? Okay.
Yes, awards are nice. But the band shell is going to seat how many people? The Arthur Pryor band shell?
200.
200. And how many did it seat?
1,000.
1,000. Is that really preservation? I rest my case. And if you'd like to comment about whether or not resolution should be passed before the residents have a chance to see what the discussion was about, I'd like to hear that.
Thank you. Warner?
I see a minute and a half left there.
I hit it by accident.
Well, I really wasn't going to mention this, but Warner Baumgartner, city historian, but I'm segueing off of Maureen here. What I have found over the years, you know, I've studied Asbury for as long as I've lived here, over 30 years, and I'm pretty much acknowledged as the local expert on local history and preservation. I would just remind everybody that I am available. Anybody that wants to know anything about history, preservation, what's gone on here for the last 30 years, both in and out of City Hall, I am at your service. What I find is nobody asks me anything. It's amazing. And then when I offer things, I'm considered to be meddling if I offer stuff. So I'm kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place as a city official. You know, please make use of my knowledge base. I would appreciate it. Aside from that, I need to complain about something, as usual, that does not work. I went downtown last week to partake in the great festivities down there in the evening, the restaurants, and the parking meters are atrocious. Impossible. They wouldn't take my coins, kept spitting my coins back out at me. And before that even happened, I could hardly even address putting the input information in because the keypad is not lit. These machines are in darkness, and the keypad is not backlit to be able to see the numbers. And on top of that, the paint is scraped off of them. So I had to do kind of like a braille thing. Let's see. This is 1, 2, okay, 5 is over here. And then 0 is down here, right? So please do something about these pay meters. They're really horrible. Maybe just the guts can be replaced with lighted keypads at the very least, and maybe empty them enough so that they actually take your money instead of forcing you to walk another block to the next one. The other thing that doesn't work that I need to mention are the aerators in Sunset Lake. I gotta tell you, this whole notion, oh, put in the aerators, it'll cure the algae, it'll fix the lake, it's bull. That will do nothing to fix the problems that Sunset Lake is experiencing. That's just a visual, feel-good, you know, kind of thing, to have water spraying up in the air. This requires a technical, scientific analysis of what's going on with the hydrology of that lake. You can't just put, you know, weed accumulating, you know, sprayer heads in there. I see the public works guys out there with hip waders, you know, clearing out the screens so that the water sprays. Completely useless, really. So, you know, the meters, Sunset Lake, and the city historian is available. Preservation, I've advocated for preservation and the character of Asbury for the better part of my adult life. So please make use of my knowledge base. Thank you.
Hello. Hi. My name is Kirsten Thoft, and I actually live in Princeton, New Jersey, but my husband and I bought a house here in January on Webb Street, and it's a two-family house, one apartment downstairs and one upstairs. I'm an architect, and I set about renovating the upstairs, which turned out great, if I do say so myself. And Phyllis, my realtor from Conover, is here this evening because she and I have been working together because the plan was and is to rent to other people for the most part during the summer and to use it ourselves off season, because I personally like the beach not in the summer so much with less crowds. And I am entranced by Asbury Park, which is why we bought here. And I'm here to give my support for summer rental defined differently to include two-family buildings, because we were surprised to hear that every time we get a new renter, which ideally is every week, we need to get a new CFO. And it's terrifically burdensome. It's not so much the money, though it's a lot more money, obviously, than getting a summer CFO, but the logistics of it is, I think, going to be impossible. And particularly if we manage to get onto the sort of weekly schedule, which we hope to, I don't see how the city can possibly do Saturday inspections in between tenants. And so I'm hoping that you guys will see that, you know, in our case in particular, but presumably in other cases, that a two-family is awfully similar to a single-family, you know, and I mean, I could speak to the types of people that we're trying to rent to, which are families, you know, older couples, et cetera, though I'm not sure that that's particularly relevant. I think it's most important that people be encouraged to do rentals. There's a huge demand, and I'd like to be able to be part of satisfying that, in addition being in the house myself. So that's all. I think that's it.
Just so you're aware,
yes,
we tabled that ordinance. It's
yes,
still going
I know.
Through,
yeah,
you know, a dialogue process. So we're not, we don't.
You know, I know you're
fix
not.
Fix it a little bit here. Fix it. We're going to try to fix it all together in one.
Perfect. Okay.
So your comments are absolutely heard.
Okay. Oh, and actually, since I have 26 seconds more, in the actual ordinance definition, it says number one is constitute the primary residence of the owner. I think that in most cases, it's not going to be someone's primary residence if they're willing to rent it out for the summer. It's probably maybe a secondary residence.
Right.
So that should probably be thought about.
Yeah, agreed, agreed.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Sure.
Tracy Rogers, Monroe Avenue. One of the things I hope you guys can discuss with everyone is the disclosure forms that Michael brought up and what it referenced to with the transitional aid and what it affects it has on the budget. Also, a lot of people I hear speak at the council meetings, and one of the things I see is a reflection that people are coming up complaining, or people are, as Warren, meddling, or, right now, the residents are a part of this community. And if they're coming up, I think it's the reflection of the elected officials to take their concerns. Because when I worked in corporate for 18 years, one of the things I learned is that if I made a mistake or something's going on, if I fix that mistake, it makes me better. And fixing the mistakes of the community are listening to their concerns and sitting there making advocate decisions that will unite the community. We keep going on about a lot of different things on how long it takes to change things. We can't change people's perspectives. We can't change how people feel about one another, but we can change policy. We can interact more. We can communicate more, which will lead to those other changes. Everything comes about in time, but we take the slowest amount of time because we don't want to listen to one another. We don't want to sit there. We want to have, you know, problems with one another. It's not. People want to come together. They want to be able to sit down, but they also want to be able to live. I've heard a guy tell me he lives in Asbury Park, doesn't leave his home on the west side. He said, I just go to work. So those are people that are not here because they felt for years they were never heard. So what are we doing to sit down and change policies that's going to affect their lives and make their lives better? This is all it takes, is just sitting here and communicating, readjusting age-old policies that we have not addressed in 50 and 60 years to make things better. It doesn't take that much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is he going to get an answer or no? Yes. Hi, Rita Miranda, 8th Avenue. I just remembered something that Maureen said about the Open Public Act. When you did the workers' compensation cases a couple of weeks ago, are we allowed to find out why somebody would be getting $77,000 and why somebody would be getting 40-something thousand? I mean, these are city employees. I mean, do they think this is a slush fund? How does workers' compensation work? I'd like to know if Fred can explain it.
Finish your all your.
Oh, the other thing I wanted to talk about was the same thing Maureen said. When you go into executive session and then you come out and then you vote, you voted on a piece of land at Kennedy Park many, many months ago. That he still hasn't purchased that. So what do you do about that? You said he put a deposit down, but it still looks the same. The people parking there, and he doesn't even own it. So what do you do about that? I mean, there's a lot of loose ends that have to, you need one person to go around. I thought the city manager would be doing it, but I guess not. You need somebody that's going to go around and check out all these things, the mercantile licenses, the dog licenses. One person could do it. I mean, we just do it from being bystanders. We know what's going on. But why is that park not closed yet after all these months? You went into executive session, you came out, you decided he was going to buy it, and yet nothing's done. There's something wrong. And workers' comp, I want that explained. These people are getting rich on workers' comp. And we pay for it, I think, don't we? Do we?
When you're done, Rita.
Yeah, I'm done.
Turn off the clock.
Well, first of all, I want to say that I don't blame. Now, first, I want to explain something. I'm not blaming you because I know you're trying to do a good job up there. I know previous councils have done lots of things, and it's really hard to change things. So I don't want you to think it's you, but I just want you to know that I, you know, I'm on your side, but the way things are, there's so many things to correct. I know it's very hard. You work very hard at that. But it's just unbelievable, the things that go on in Asbury Park. Okay.
Fred, please.
I can give you some information about the workers' comp. The city has a contract with the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, which is a joint insurance fund. And in their capacity, under their contract with the city, the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund handles all workers' compensation and other liability cases that are filed against the city, slip and fall cases, as well as workers' comp cases. There is an attorney who is general counsel to the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, and when cases are filed against the city, the NJIIF evaluates them and sends them out to their panel. They have various panel counsels who they assign different cases to on behalf of the constituent members of the JIF, and Asbury Park is a constituent member of this JIF. And the attorneys who are assigned to handle these cases appear before workers' comp judges. They prepare reports that are sent back through the general counsel for the NJIIF, and then a recommendation may be made by that counsel to the mayor and council here in Asbury Park with regard to the strengths and weaknesses of the case and whether it's advantageous to the city to consider settling the case. And based upon the reports that the mayor and council receive from their attorney at the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, then the council may make a determination to settle cases. So these are recommendations that are made by attorneys that are handling the cases through the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, which provides for basically a defense in all of these matters.
I know, but maybe you should fight some of these cases so that
okay,
these...
Rita.
Oh, but I mean, you got to do something. That's not a good answer.
Okay, that's a legal answer. That's how the system works. We can go into this further. I'll call you tomorrow.
All right, but one thing. Who pays the $77,000? Where does that come from?
What's $77,000?
Where?
What's $77,000?
Well, say somebody wins the claim, like on one of those, I don't want to mention his name, but he got $77,000. Who pays it?
Some could come out of the deductible and some could come from the city, correct?
Yeah, correct.
Right.
Hello, Mayor and Council, Jerry Scrano, Long Branch. I wanted to ask you about, I asked about the copper boat on Monday night. Did anybody get back to you if it's in storage or being restored to be put back on the north end? And when they were talking about, I wanted to bring up about affordable housing. My idea is any building that's sold or land sold under 100,000, we should ask Interface or somebody else to buy it and put that back on the affordable housing market instead of letting it go off to being an investment house from somebody out of town. We should have people moving into those houses to bring back neighborhoods. Now, I heard the plea from an investor who came to town tonight to buy a house and wanted to do a summer rental. If you really want to see what happens with summer rentals and winter rentals, please take a drive to Elberon and Oakhurst, land of summer rentals and winter rentals. And if you want Asbury to go back to that, that's a good way to go. And the other thing is, I wanted to say is, if people are going to run Airbnbs, you have to find a way to tax them just like the hotels pay a hotel fee. Because if people are going to run a business out of the house, they should pay their share. It's bad enough you have to give away tax abatements and pilot programs. This is a way to get some money back. If people want to run a business out of their building, then they should pay for it. The other thing is, how are we doing with signs on the boardwalk that you have to wear shoes? Because on 4th of July, I told the police officer about that, and he went to tell the lady, and she kept walking barefoot on the boardwalk. There's no reason for us to pick up a tab for someone getting the splinter on their foot. The other thing is all the vehicles are gonna have GPS and decals on their cars. That's it.
That's it? Okay, well, you asked me about GPS and we said yes.
Okay, but are they on all the decals on all the vehicles and stuff?
Same as we said last meeting, yes.
Okay.
GPS, no. We're hoping August, September.
The police car shipment came in on Monday morning at 9:30. We're scheduling that installation. And until the final budget is passed, at this point, we can't do anything else because we've maxed out our funds with it. But the police department, I think it was like 35 or 40 more cars with it. So
okay.
The police department is getting it next.
Well, I just mean other cars too that everybody has. Now, how are we doing with the signs on the boardwalk?
Okay, yeah. Well, number one, I don't know if we have an ordinance saying you have to wear shoes on the boardwalk. So if we don't have an ordinance, we can't put up a sign.
Well, then you make an ordinance.
We'll look into it. Okay. The storage, we're told it is in storage, the ship.
It's being restored?
No, it is in storage.
Okay.
That's what we were told, it is in storage. We'll reach out to Interfaith and tell them they should buy every house in Asbury Park under $100,000.
No, the thing is, you give them land for free so they can build new houses. Why are houses going for $60,000 being fixed up and a half a month later being rented for $1,800?
This council is giving nobody land for free. So let's get off that right now. Interfaith.
Well, I'm just an idea. That's the person that's the closest.
Nobody is getting land for free from this council. Maybe that's happened in the past. It hasn't happened since we've been here.
I know. Listen, we appreciate the good work you're doing. I'm just saying, you know, it just.
The Airbnbs, we're looking into it. Other towns have enacted maybe ordinances that are probably only going to get sued. So we don't want to, again, waste taxpayers.
On a lawsuit.
On a lawsuit. But we are looking into it. What were your other questions? I think.
Well, you answered enough. That's good enough. I forgot the rest. Talk to you later. Thank you very much for listening.
Hi, everyone. Phyllis Mafucci, 510 Deer Lake Drive. I just wanted to clarify something that I said at the last meeting when I was talking about summer rentals, and I said having rules and not having rules. And first, I want to say thank you. I appreciate that the council has tabled this discussion and vote until you get all the information and determine what rules and what issues are coming up that you need to address so that you can make the right decisions moving forward. I do think that there should be rules for homeowners, and I think that there should be consequences for those people, both homeowners and tenants, that don't follow the rules. But I don't think that we should make it so hard for investors to invest in property and improve our community. The one thing that I thought about recently, Councilwoman Clayton had an issue with the hotel and all of the noise going on and was very successful with that. And I'm not really sure if there is a fine or a citation that you get if for a noise complaint. But if there is, I think that that's something that can be worked into summer rentals and summer rental leases. What I have here is a copy of a short-term rental agreement that Conover uses, and I've made some changes to it that if there is a citation that, say, somebody gets a noise complaint, and the police go out to the house, say, at 1 o'clock in the morning because of noise, and a citation is issued, and that's a fine that will go to the homeowner, but the homeowner can then take a security deposit or part of the security deposit that we take as a result of any possible damage to the home and make the tenant pay for that citation. So not only are you holding the homeowner accountable, you're also holding tenants accountable. So if we take, normally we take $1,000, we can increase that security deposit, advise our clients, don't take $1,000, take $1,500, so that if there are any noise complaints and citations, the homeowner can hold that and pay the city, and it gets included in the lease. So what I've done is I've highlighted all of the areas where I've made adjustments that would reflect what I've just discussed, and this could maybe be part of what the new ordinance includes.
I think if you give that to Fred, Phyllis, we're actually going to put like a very small temporary committee together about the COs to reach out and get the feedback to put into the ordinance. And your other suggestion about the animal house ordinance is one that we're going to do a standalone ordinance, not tied to CO, hopefully in the next couple of weeks, which it should also, or for the next meeting. So if you give that to Fred, we'll take a look at it. And if we think it should be, Yvonne and I are on the committee, we'll incorporate it in.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Fred, would the homeowner get the citation or would the person making the noise get the citation?
No. Homeowner is ultimately responsible, but it depends on the circumstances of the particular matter. It could be
Motion to close public?
Move it.
Second.
I should have responded sooner, but just a couple quick things. Warner, how dare you?
What?
How dare you say nobody calls you? I call you all the time and pick your brain.
Thank you. I appreciate your
right. I do, and you're a wealth of knowledge. Nobody ever said the aerators were the solving of the problem in Sunset Lake, but they do help put oxygen and move the water. So we know that, and that's factual. Every lake that has the same problem has aerators. We know that's not the solution. Eileen is part of the committee. I know you volunteered for it. We have a problem there, and we don't have $20 million to dredge it. So we have to find a simpler solution.
Those pay meters.
Pay meters, we're aware that they're terrible, and we're doing all we can to stay on top of it. And we haven't hidden that from anybody. Some of them don't take coins. Michael, if you want to.
I think there's nine that aren't fully functional right now. Two of them don't take coins, spin them back out. One or two of them don't take credit cards but take cash. The other ones take cash but don't take credit cards. We've had nothing but problems with the company with parts. As I've mentioned before, the company's based in Canada, and it's not like it was 5, 10, 15 years ago where everyone keeps parts on a shelf. It's on demand. So it's, instead of just calling up and getting something overnighted and it's here in a day or two, it's they get it from somewhere else. It comes to us, and it's been incredibly slow. One of the concerns that we've had with the keypads, and the backlighting of them, was they came up with a solution that they would drill holes and put like a little book reading light. And I called that idea moronic, because one of the issues that they have is that with so much moisture in our air, it's actually making the receipts harder to print out. So the next generation of machines should either be fully blowerized, for lack of a better word, internally, or a standalone unit where moisture can't get in. So their idea of, they said one of the big problems they have is moisture in the unit, and then they want to drill holes in it. And I was like, that's moronic. So we have major problems there. The next generation of meters, we talked about this at the parking committee meeting 2 weeks ago, is we need to make sure that there's blowers there so that the dollars are taken and that the receipts are given, which means we also have to make sure that there's power there, because we can't obviously put a solar-powered kiosk in shade, because then it doesn't work. But we're looking to replace them within the next year or so, because they just don't work. It's about the experience here, and it is incredibly frustrating to have to walk across the street, then go down the street, and then turn the corner to get a meter to work. We know it's bad, and it's not going to get any better anytime soon. We have to get the parts, and that's on them. We respond immediately, because it's online, but it's the company. And there was one question from Tracy, I don't know where he went, about the financial disclosure forms. The financial disclosure forms are required to be filled out annually by any high ranking, for lack of a better term, and volunteer planning board members, zoning board members, myself, the council, appointed members to disclose what finances you own. It's your home, any property you own, so that it's a tool to weed out corruption. As part of the MOU with the state in which we receive transitional aid, we are supposed to have it filled out. It can impact transitional aid, but this year, thanks to Cindy, we're actually fully compliant for the first time in a while. So thank you again, and thank you. Did I get everything?
And then Tracy, just something, a quick follow-up on what you said. I hear you, and I agree with you to a point, and I disagree with you to a point. You and I have had many conversations. I think this council is the most accessible council in probably the history of Asbury Park. And I'll go back to 1897, 1887, whatever it is. Just, I mean, we have two meetings a week where we'll take public input, not one, two. We listen. We don't just sweep it under the rug. We do follow through. We give answers. People may not like the answers, but they're answers. I know Pam sent me emails. I've responded. I list a public phone number. My home phone number is 732-988-7915. Anybody can call me anytime. I'll gladly set up a meeting anytime with anybody at City Hall. We've met at City Hall. There's a lot that we're doing that people don't know about. And I mean, we're not the type to slap ourselves on the back. And as Pam's right, it is a crazy time in America. We have to come together as a united community. And there's no question about it. Last Saturday night, there was a special service at Lutheran Atonement Church at 308 First Avenue. Yvonne and myself attended. So
I attended one on Sunday.
Okay, so you may not know it because we don't go out there and, like, you know, take pictures of his photo ops or something that's going on, but we were at a very good meeting last night. Again, Friday at 6 p.m., we're asking everybody to meet us on Springwood Avenue, and it says it's going to start on time. And I believe this is going to start on time, so we're hopeful everybody will join us Saturday at 6. A house divided cannot stand against itself. So, I mean, we have to work together, and we are working together. And again, I believe we are the most accessible council in the history. Again, you may not like our answers, but we will follow through and give you an answer. So, again, I thank you. And Pam, I thank you. And I have no problem with Cindy posting those four questions again. One of them was, this is just totally illegal. I mean, we can't put something on a referendum breaking state law. I mean, they wanted to change the hours of clubs to, like, from 2 a.m. to 8 a.m. I mean, the state law says no, so of course it was turned down. So, I mean, but I have no problem putting those back up. And we just, if somebody puts in a request for a referendum with this new form of government, there are, it has to be done the right way. Or, you know, we're not looking just to shoot them down to shoot them down. But they have to meet, like, the test, or else if we don't shoot them down, Freehold's going to shoot them down. So I have no problem with Cindy releasing, like, the findings again.
Well, I have to pass because it is in litigation right now.
Okay. So, but you can release what you read that night.
That's in the minutes. It's
on the website already?
Yeah, it's in the minutes.
Okay, so that's up on the website already. Why they were termed deficient. And thank you. Next.
We're on to minutes. We have two sets this evening, June 29, 2016 executive session and June 29, 2016 regular session. Can I have a motion to approve both sets of the minutes?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? No. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yep.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
On to a consent agenda. There's three items for consideration on a consent agenda this evening. First is 2016-302, which is a resolution authorizing the payment of payroll in the amount of $986,147.06. Resolution 2016-303, resolution to credit sewer account for 601 Lake Avenue, which is block 2404, lot 9. And resolution 2016-304, award a contract for regional contribution agreement for 1027 First Avenue. Does anybody wish any of these items to be pulled off consent? Motion to approve the three resolutions.
Move it.
Second.
Move it.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Individual resolutions. The first one is resolution 2016-301, approving special events wedding application as presented on July 11, 2016. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Okay. Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember or Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to resolution 2016-305, resolution authorizing the payment of bills in the amount of $8,622,548.87.
Move it.
Hold on. Purchase order 16-01834 has been requested to be pulled from this bill list. And also, Councilmember Chapman must abstain from line item 6-04-55502-000201.
Move it.
Thank you.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman, with the exception of that one item?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-306, Sustainable Land Use Pledge. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-307, resolution endorsing the adoption of green building practices for civic, commercial, and residential buildings. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-308, resolution authorizing the place-to-place transfer, which is an expansion of premises, a plenary retail consumption license, 1303-3304-7009, for AP 30 Property Holder Holdings, LLC. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
I sing for that.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-309, a resolution approving liquor license with special conditions for 1114 Main License LLC, doing business as Cascada, for the 2016-2017 licensing year. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-310, resolution authorizing in-rem foreclosing proceedings relating to real property located at 1411 Memorial Drive, Block 10103, Lot 4. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-311, resolution amending temporary appropriations for 2016. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-312, resolution authorizing refund for special events reimbursement. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to ordinances. We have ordinance 2016-31 for introduction. An ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 7-16 entitled Angled Parking of Chapter 7 Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park. Can I have a motion to introduce Ordinance 2016-31?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for this ordinance for July 27, 2016. We're on to second reading, public hearing. First one is Ordinance 2016-28, which is a bond ordinance providing for Fourth Avenue improvements by and into the City of Asbury Park and the County of Monmouth, State of New Jersey, appropriating $2,700,000. Therefore, including a grant expected to be received from the New Jersey Department of Transportation in the amount of $342,247, and authorizing the issuance of $2,700,000 bonds or notes of the city to finance a part of the cost thereof. Can I have a motion to open Ordinance 2016-28 to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Anybody there? No. Okay. Hi, Warner Baumgartner. Is this for the repaving of 4th Avenue now that the Sunset Avenue Bridge is completed? Is that what this is for?
Isn't it
more extensive improvements? Oh, Michael.
It's more extensive. It's repaving. Sewer, both storm and sanitary, is needed.
Ah, okay. So this will be a ground opening and replacement of infrastructure also.
We're going to televise. We know that there's some areas that are going to need a complete reconstruction of the sanitary lines.
Okay. It seemed $2,700,000 seems like a lot for just repaving. So
repaving would have been about $700,000.
Okay.
The sewer lines there are pretty much all shot.
And most of this is being paid for by a local bond.
Correct.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Maureen Nevin, Deer Lake Court. I'm sorry. Most of it's being paid by a bond? I don't see that. I see the bond is $341,000, right? Or that's a grant?
That's the grant.
And how much is the bond? Well, the bond is our indebtedness, right? We're going to issue a bond.
The bond is going to be issued for 2.7. Well, let me rephrase that. We are authorized to spend up to $2.7 million.
And we will.
So if the bids come in at 2.5, we spend $2.5 million. $340,000 of that is paid for with a DOT grant.
Okay. How much more do we have? Because I saw something on a couple of weeks ago. We had some paperwork on the ordinances, and it said that this would be within what the city can still bond for. And it seemed like it was, you know, maybe 10 million we had, 15 million do we have? How much more can we bond for?
It's much more, quite honestly, than the $15 million. You're referring to the TAN note, which was the tax anticipation note, where if we needed to have cash, which is a little different calculation. Currently, the city is either 1.77 or 1.91% of the equalized value of the 3.5% that we can legally go up to. So we're roughly at half of what we could borrow for the future.
We're about how much?
About half.
Half. And when you say future, is that?
If tomorrow the city wanted to do $30 million, we could do $30 million if we had the down payment. That's the future.
Until we get that debt down.
Well, there's pay downs every year, obviously, required by law. One of the things the new CFO and myself have already discussed is putting together the long-term debt management plan. This is a stable funding over the 20-year period. So the average increase over the 20 years, which we anticipate going down, is $37 on the average house. That's it. That covers everything.
When you say $37...
Dollars
a...
Tax increase on the average house over the next 20 years.
Are you saying for this particular one or our current debt?
For this, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Statutorily, with the Department of Transportation, with the funding, is that grant guaranteed?
The grant right now is still up in the air. So what we're doing is, this is authorized. We're not doing anything. The project could be canceled. It could be fully funded for ourselves. If we know we need to do the road, obviously. Yeah. But with the transportation trust fund, that's what Tracy's talking about, it's up in the air right now. This, along with, quite honestly, the other applications, the other part of the road program, we don't know what's going to happen. One of the questions that everyone is asking is, well, what if we do it? Well, are we going to get reimbursed? No one has any answers right now. So we're in a holding pattern, but this just authorizes us to do this. We don't even anticipate discussions of design of this until September, which by then something hopefully is going to be taken care of. As the papers have shown, Senate President Sweeney has presented the governor with some ideas, who's out right now at the Republican National Convention. So nothing's going to happen, I don't think, until next week. But there'll be movement on this.
But when we were authorized the grant, was it done on stipulation that we're going to keep it, even with the funding situation?
It's our grant. No, we get it. It's our grant.
Okay.
Hi, Frida Moreno. On 4th Avenue, are you changing the water lines too? Because the gas lines were done through the whole city.
We don't do the water lines. What happens when you do a road program, when you get to about 50 to 75%, you submit it to the utilities. You want to try to get it to the utilities 30 to 60 days in advance so that they know to make improvements and they can configure their schedule around us. One of the things DPW is in the process of doing is ranking and rating all the streets so we can actually come up with a 5-6 year plan of road improvements, give it to the utilities so we can coordinate that together so it's cheaper for everyone involved. Mm-hmm. So the utilities do get the program. They do get ahead of time that, okay, water needs to come in and fix these mains or fix these pipes. Gas company, everyone gets it.
Mm-hmm. That's $37 that you told Maureen. Is that per 100 or is that all together? The increase.
It's $37.
For what?
A year.
Oh. Okay. I thought, you know, it.
Thank you.
Didn't sound right.
Motion to close 2016-28 to the public?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor? Aye. Have a motion to adopt ordinance 2016-28.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
On to ordinance 2016-29, establishing a restricted parking space for use by handicapped persons for property located at 1109 Grand Avenue, designated as Block 3401, Lot 8 in the City of Asbury Park, and amending and supplementing Section 7-36, entitled Handicap Parking, a Chapter 7 Traffic of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion to open ordinance 2016-29 to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-29.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Next is ordinance 2016-30, which is that summer rental ordinance. Can I just have a motion to table it, please?
Motion to table.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion to adjourn.
Move it.
See everybody Friday.